So I'm gonna get started. First of all, thank you for joining my session. Today I'm gonna talk about a new open source solution, which is called Full Metal Update. I think it's pretty cool, but of course I'm slightly biased since I'm one of the main maintainers of this solution. So Full Metal Update, spoiler, but so you can see it as a mix between Fedora Atomic and Flatpak. But with a twist, it's optimized for embedded devices. So that's the idea of Full Metal Update. How did it start? How did we start this whole project? What was the inception of the project? Basically, it started with a beer. So I was talking with a friend about how Docker containers completely changed the way that we are deploying applications to data centers. Then we started to think, could we reuse the same kind of solution to deploy applications to embedded devices? Moving on with wine, then we started to talk about an architecture. What could we do if we started to put our applications within containers? So in that example, we have one container running a Qt application, and this application could access the GPU and the touchscreen. Then we have one application running an MQTT stack, and only that one container running an MQTT stack, and only that container could access the network. Then these two containers would communicate with each other over a virtual network. So that was the idea, trying to split the different features of your application in multiple boxes or containers. One of the advantages of doing that is for each container, you can use C groups. So, for instance, for the container running the Qt application, you could choose to limit the memory usage to 100 megabytes. Or for the container running the MQTT stack, you could limit the bandwidth that could be actually used by that container. The big plus of doing that is from a security standpoint. If somehow someone manages to break into one of your container and to hack one of your application, for instance, the MQTT stack, if they want to, for instance, run a denial of service attack, they're gonna be limited by the C groups and they will never be able to use more than 10 megabit per second. So that was the idea behind using C groups with containers. Of course, the fact of using containers is ever bringing more advantages. For instance, you are solving all the dependency issues that you could have when you are designing your system. Like you could have, in theory, two applications running Qt, one Qt5, one Qt4, and they are both running in their own container, so you cannot have any dependency issues. Moving on, then we were talking about security, how by using seccomp, we could limit access to system calls. We could use as well like rootless containers to limit what you could do even when you are running in the container and even if someone is hacking your container, what they could do when they are still stuck in the box. Mandatory access control policy and so on. In the early morning, we are still discussing if using Docker for such a system would be a good idea. Our conclusion was probably not. Why not? Because Docker, one of the cool features of that software, it's doing delta updates. So if you are updating two versions of a container, like between the new version and the old version, it's just gonna update the delta, so the differences between these two containers. But to do that, they are using a specific file systems. In the past, they were using OFS. Nowadays, they are using Overlay 2. And they are not resistant to power failure. So it's definitely a no-go if you are developing a solution to update devices, embedded devices, that might be in a box somewhere on the other side of the world, and if somehow there is a power failure and it's completely breaking down the device, it's absolutely not acceptable. Another thing, when you are using Docker, you are using multiple layers of software that might not be needed if you want to use containers on embedded devices. So we thought, Docker, maybe not for such a solution. The next morning, we decided to check, okay, that sounds like a great idea to use Docker containers, or containers, to update devices, but does it already exist? It does. Actually, so this discussion, I had it about 2 years ago. Took a while before we managed to finish something. But it does exist. In the past, so 2 years ago, it was called resin.io. Nowadays, it's called Balena. And they have a solution which is based on Docker containers to do updates. They replaced the regular way to do the Delta updates by something which is called librsync, a bit like SW update. And they use a dual partition system for their host Linux. So it's a pretty neat solution. We use it at VTechio on a couple of projects. But they have one thing that usually we don't really like, at least which is not acceptable for most of our customers. It's when you want to deploy a new software, you need to push it to their private Git repository. And then it's going to build in the container, and then it's going to be shipped to your targets. So for most of our customers, this is not really acceptable. So we decided maybe we could do something else based on containers and replace the Delta update system of Docker by maybe again something else. So we started to think, okay, what do we need if we want to develop our own solution? We need a runtime to run the containers, a build system to create the containers, because if we are not using Docker, we cannot use anymore the Docker files. We need a system to do Delta updates. Ideally, we need a backend to manage the different updates. And on the embedded side, we need a client to download the updates and a tool to manage the container's lifecycle. So that's basically our shopping list. Let's look at the step one. So if you want a runtime for a container, you have about 20 options. So we decided, okay, what could we use that in 10 years would still exist? Then there was the Open Container Initiative, and they started to develop a runtime specification, basically for containers. So we thought, at least with that, we are sure that probably in 10 years, there will still be one implementation existing for that standard. Right now, there are three, as far as I know. One of them is RunC. So basically, you can see RunC as the low level for Docker. If you are using Docker containers, you are using actually RunC. There is another implementation from Intel, which is Clear Containers. And finally, there is one implementation done by Oracle, which is called Railcar. So these three implementations are supporting exactly the same standard. We could not go for Clear Containers because it's Intel and it's only compatible with x86. It's not a big surprise. Railcar is not maintained anymore. Like since 1 year, they are not doing anything new. So RunC was kind of an obvious solution. And on top of that, I mean, it's just the low level of Docker, so we know that it's working. Step two, we needed a way to create the containers. So the people from the Meta virtualization, they are doing a great job. But since we started our project, even before actually they started to really work on that, we have our own implementation for that. So it's based on Yocto, because Yocto is just great to actually build your application and pull all the dependencies for your application. One requirement as well was something that could work on ARM and x86. So with Yocto, since we built everything from scratch, there is no problem at all. And what we decided as well to do, it's to put the build system itself, so the Yocto build system, within a Docker container. The good thing as well, since we are using Yocto to build the container, it's specially optimized for your processor, which is not the case if you use a Docker file with a generic architecture and you are trying to kind of building your container on top of, I don't know, an Alpine distribution or an Ubuntu distribution. And it's very lightweight as well, because since we use Yocto, it's really just pulling the minimum set of dependencies to build your application. Then we needed a way to handle Delta updates, so to replace that specific part of Docker. We decided to use OS3. Because OS3 is used by Red Hat, by Automotive Grade Linux, Genevi, here, Flatpak. So there are really a couple of big projects using that solution when it comes to update. So OS3, what is OS3? It's basically a Git for binaries. It's fully atomic, managing Delta updates, and we are using it actually to update the different containers running on the system and the operating system itself. So basically, what we did, we reused the meta updater, and which is already implementing all you need to manage updates for the Linux host system. But if you use this meta updater, every time you do an update, basically you need to restart the target because it's updating the host system. So it can update the kernel, for instance. So there is not really a choice for it. But since we wanted to be able to update our containers independently of the Linux host system, we decided to have a second OS2 directory that we would use just to manage the containers themselves. Another thing, everything is happening in the background when you use OS3, which means that your customers, they can still use their product even when an update is ongoing. So if we look at the architecture of, sorry for that. If we look at the architecture, basically, what do we have? On the left, we have Yocto, which is building the operating system and the containers. And it's pushing the result of the build to an OS3 server. In that use case, it's running locally on your computer. On the other side, on your embedded device, you basically have an OS3 client that can pull the modifications and that is just gonna pull the delta updates between two versions of the software. And then you can independently update the operating system or the containers. Step four, we wanted to use, to have a backend and a frontend to manage the different updates. The obvious choice for us was just to use Hogbit. But what we did, we decided to, in our Yocto build system, to have a BB class that every time actually you build a container or you build an operating system, the result of the build will be automatically pushed to Yocto, to Hogbit. How does this work? So basically, when you build something, first it's pushed to OS3, we get then the commit ID, and then we put in the metadata of the package that we're gonna push to you, to Hogbit, this commit ID and the name of the image that you just built. By using that, then we can easily, when we receive this information on the client side, we can easily know, okay, what do we need to update and update it. It's cloud agnostic, so basically the servers are Hogbit and OS3 server, we just provide you the setup in a Docker Compose, and you can just run it on AWS, Google Cloud, or Azure. It's really your choice. It's working out of the box. Step five and six, so we needed a client, so we needed something to run on the embedded device. We decided to use the Hogbi client from Rook, so which is kind of a competitor of SW Update. But why did we choose specifically this client? It's because it's developed in Python, and we just wanted to do a bit of Python, basically. So we just went for that. What we did, we integrated to that client OS3 and systemd to manage basically the life cycles of the different containers. So right now we have a system that can pull the containers and then use systemd to start them and stop them. If we look at the full picture, the full architecture of the system, basically on the left side, we have Yocto, which is building the different containers and the operating system. This is pushed to the, this is actually kind of committed to an OS3, a local OS3. Then it's pushed to the distant OS3 server. We get back the commit ID, and then we push like the information about the commit ID and the container or the OS that was built to Hogbit. So you don't need to do anything with Hogbit to add a new image. It's all done automatically. When you build something, you will, if you build a container, you're gonna see actually the new container popping out in the Hogbit UI, and then you can just create a new distribution and install it on the target. On the other side, we've got the FMU client, which is polling the Hogbit server. If there is a new update available, it's using OS3 to pull the delta between the two versions of your application or the Linux operating system. If it was an update for the container itself, then it's using systemd to stop the container and restart it. If it's the operating system, it's simply restarting the whole Linux operating system. You might have noticed that I did not talk about security, or really not much about security when I was explaining full metal update, because basically there is not much integration. We did not integrate that many things about security by default in Full Metal Update. Why that? Because I really think that security for each project should be custom. Like, you're not gonna invest the same amount of money to secure a water tank or to secure a secure vault. Does not make any sense. For instance, if you want to secure a system, an automotive system, you can use Upten, which is great for that. Like, you have all the public key infrastructure. It's just perfect, but it's super heavy to manage. So, I mean, if you use that then for your water tank, you're gonna spend so much money just to manage your certificates that it might not make sense anymore. So I really think that every time you talk about security with a customer, you should first talk about threat modeling and then talk about, okay, what do you really need? What makes sense for your project? So what's available? Actually, everything is available on GitHub. The first part you need to run if you want to try Full Metal Update is the cloud demo. So basically, it's a Docker Compose. It's gonna start a Hogbit server instance and an OS2 instance in this container. Then you've got the Full Metal Update Yocto demo. So it's just a Docker container which embed the whole building system. So you have a couple of commands that you can run, and you can select the machine, and you can do the sync with the different repo that you offer. We are compatible right now with i.mx6, with Raspberry Pi 3, with STM32. You can build an OS image, you can build like all the containers in one go, or you can build a specific container. The different meta that we provide for Yocto, actually it's in two parts. First, we've got the meta Full Metal Update, which is all the parts that are not hardware specific. So it's the container framework. So that's the recipe for RunSea, basically. You find in that meta the Python client for Full Metal Update, and the different BB classes that we are using to push the containers and the OS images to OS3 and to Hogbit. Then we have the meta Full Metal Update extra, which includes everything which is specific to a machine. So we have all the GPU stuff, dynamic layers per machine, just to avoid that, to spread all the configuration for a specific machine a bit everywhere in different recipes. The containers recipes, so we had to put the containers recipes in the extra meta Full Metal Update extra, because in some cases, it can be specific to the hardware. For instance, if you are running a container on an i.mx6 and you want to access the GPU, it's specific. So you need to give access to a specific hardware to your container. And of course, we've got the image creation scripts in the Meta Full Metal Update extra. So I thought I would be trendy and start by a bit of machine learning. And so what I'm gonna show you, so I wanted to do that on stage at the beginning, but then I realized it would not be convenient. So I'm gonna show you a video where I'm actually running a container, including a TensorFlow Lite model, and do an inference. Skip that. So that's, if you are not familiar with that, that's the Hogbit UI. And right now I already created a distribution with TensorFlow, and I already deployed, I'm gonna go a bit. So here I'm deploying from scratch a new container on the target. So that's the cool thing as well. Even if it was not at all at the beginning on your target, you can just decide to add new containers to the target. And in that case, I just decided to add a new container with a deep learning model and to run it with TensorFlow Lite. So now I'm just connecting on SSH on the target, and I'm just gonna use systemd to run that container. So that's done, so you get your inference. So I just did an inference on this image, and you can see that on an i.mx6, the inference was done in 200 milliseconds. There is a very cool thing which is developed right now by the people from Google, if you're interested in deep learning. It's what they call so quantized networks. So instead of using floating values, they use integer values to run their deep learning algorithm. And on processors like the i.MX6, when you cannot run any hardware acceleration, you can still use these networks and have very, very short inference time. So basically right now we are in 200 milliseconds, but if you take the lightest model, you can run the same inference in 35 milliseconds on a processor which is 12 years old, I think, more or less. So it's super interesting, and there is, and if you are interested on that topic, you can try as well the stuff from Facebook. They are doing one thing which is called QNN pack, and it's even 2 to 4 times faster. I did not get the chance to try it, but it looks super interesting. So that was how we can update, so with full mail, how we can add a completely new container to an existing image. Now we can look if we want to update the operating system. So on this example, what I'm doing basically, I'm taking so a Linux image and I'm just gonna add strace to that image. So right now you can see that strace is not available on the target. And I'm just gonna use so the meta updater and all the stuff that was done by the people of here to update actually my target. The thing which is different from their system, it's what we provide basically is a connector to Hogbit that you can use to connect to OS3. So right now you can see the client is running on the top, so it's actually polling on Hogbit. And right now it just got a new revisor, a new thing to pull. So it's just actually pulling it and it's installing it and restarting the target. So we already received a notification that the update was successful. Of course, we did not test anything. So just to say it's successful makes not that much sense, but anyway. And then we just reconnect on the target and now you can see that basically strace was installed on the target. So that was another demo. And finally, the last demo. It's about Qt containers. So we are running a Qt application within a container, a RunC container. And what we're gonna do, we're just going to update that application with full metal update. And what's interesting, it's even if there is no notification for the user, but you can see that it's really the switch between two versions is super fast. So right now we are just creating so the different distributions with Hogbit to be able to update our target. I'm just gonna skip that step. Okay, so what we are doing right now, actually we are assigning a new distribution to our target. So we are just moving to step 2. I'm just gonna pause. So if you look on the top right of the UI next to the map symbol, you see there is nothing. What we're gonna do now, we're going to add the possibility to use different languages on this specific UI. So you can see it's really seamless. Like it's taking like 1-2 seconds and then you get the new version up and running. Basically what happened, it was just downloaded in the background and then when it's ready with systemd, we stop the old container and then we start the new container. And you have your new Qt application up and running on your target and you did not see anything. The good thing as well, we just updated the delta between these two versions. So it's, I mean, when you have a Qt application, which is quite often 50 megabytes, if you just modify like a couple of lines of source code, you're just gonna update this couple of lines of source code. Then the second part of this demo is, so first we play a bit, of course, I switched to French because I guess you got it, I'm French. The second part, we're adding so the support for a credit card. So it's a demo application that was developed by Qt for electrical vehicle charging station. And in that version, if you go, like, you can set up, okay, how much, and then, like, you can put your credit card number and do, like, you are charging your car, basically. Okay. So it's just what we did. So if we look at the roadmap, so what we are planning to do in very near future, it's first, so the port to STM32MP1 is already done. Port the full solution to i.mx8. As I already told you, it's already working on Raspberry Pi 3. It's already working on i.mx6, the Saber SDP. Soon I'm gonna do the port on Raspberry Pi 4. What I want to do, I don't know if you know the tool Scopeo, it's to do the integration with that tool. It was already partially done. So Scopeo is kind of cool because then it's allowing you to pull containers from an OCI registry and to store them in an OS3 directory. So you get the advantages of using an OCI registry, so regular Docker containers, but still you are using OS3 to store them. So you get the advantages of your OCI repository and the advantages of using OS3. So I think it would be pretty cool. I want to do the integration with the container network interface, because right now, if you want to enable the communication over a virtual network between two containers, it's not easy to implement. And with CNI, it should be quite straightforward. And then we need to port full metal update to more Yocto versions. Right now we are supporting Rocco and Thud, but we would like to support as well Warrior and Sumo. Everything is available on GitHub. We have a website with a first version of the documentation and a couple of rules if you want to contribute. So, do you have any questions?
So, you mentioned that you need to port different stuff from your stack.
Actually, it's just about the bootloader, and it's how you start OS3. So, it's basically rather porting the meta updater than porting full metal update. Full metal update is absolutely not dependent of the hardware. Go ahead. It's up to you. I mean, what we provide, it's a Docker Compose, which is going to run on OS3 server and a Hogbit server. What's happening in the background on the Yocto side, if you have more than one developer working in the project, is every time we are about to push something to the remote OS3 repository, we pull what's available to avoid having inconsistencies. But the management of the OS3 server, if you want to remove versions and at some point because they don't make sense anymore, that you have to manage by yourself. Actually, the bigger part is Python, which maybe, if I think about it now, was a mistake, but because we need to include a couple of libraries just to run Python, it's what's taking most of the space on the image. Because the host Linux, the Linux to run the containers, it's super small besides that. I mean, we just have runc, and we just have like the Linux kernel, a very simple root file system, and that's about it. But all the stuff we need to bring just to run the FMU client, it's quite a bit of stuff because it's in Python. Right now, I would say the image is about 200 megabytes for the host Linux system. But we did not put any effort in that. It could be reduced quite a bit, just working a bit on that. So the root file system, since we are using OS3, is read-only for most parts. There are a couple of parts that are read-write, but most parts are read-only. Yeah, so, and the containers are running on the second partition. So containers are on an application partition, and then we've got a rootfs with the host Linux, basically. And both of them, both of them have their own OS3. Yeah. No, not any, because that's the OS3 architecture, basically. So it's. Yeah, it's done at the beginning, so it's whole OS3 is booting. They are using a RAMFS. It's the meta updater, basically. So first there is the bootloader, which is starting. Then there is the RAMFS, which starts. The RAMFS is making the decision about which part, I mean, so then it's, yeah, so which part of the file system should be used, which commit in the file system would be used. And then it's using hard links to recreate a file system on the fly. But if you want to learn more about that, in 2016 at Embedded Linux, at the Embedded Linux conference, there was a very, very good talk about how OS3 is working, which was done by the guys who developed the meta updater. Yeah, go ahead.
Just to follow up on that a little bit, you said you generally follow OS3's guidelines for exactly the answer to that question, which is like use var, use a standard file system
Yeah, yeah. We just stick with what was done with the meta updater. The only twist in our approach is to have a different partition for the containers with its own OS3 repository. And we're using a specific mod to actually check out the different containers, which is called bare user, which is specifically done for that by the people who developed OS3. Because if you use the meta updater, so the general OS3, you have to restart the system if you want the update to be applied. So that's why we needed to have a second partition with a different OS3, because we wanted to be to be able to restart an application without restarting the full system. I'm sorry, I did not get the question.
Yeah, you have device-specific configuration, like maybe identification, like a certain
device-specific. Yeah, we use OS3 for that.
Do you maintain a separate tree for every device, or write it, and then have OS3 perform the merge, and then have to
So far, we never had to do that, but I would probably, from my perspective, I'm going to talk about customers, I would use, like, for a specific customer, a specific OS3. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just. Yeah, I mean, it could be your choice, but it's really then it's about the architecture of your system somehow. It's like. It's correct. Mm-hmm. That's the var directory, yeah. But exactly, the var directory is just, yeah, it's just skipped. It's just read-write. It's just there for that, basically. Yeah, sorry.
How much
That's an excellent question. I never checked. But it would be, that's a good idea. It looks quite fast, but it looks quite fast. And I'm a human being, so but it would need to be measured. Yeah, it's just the meta updater. I mean, like, it's the time, how much time do they spend in the RAMFS? Then, of course, the service, so then it's systemd, the time for the full metal update service to be started, but it's not critical, I would say that part. Okay, that's all I have, guys. Thanks a lot.